Philip Boadin, major today.
Major, yeah.
Philip couldn't be here today, so Professor Ajay Dalai is going to present. I just want to mention that Professor Dalai, he came to our lab in 2003, 2004, and while he was on sabbatical and wrote some very nice papers with Bert on water effect. The title of the talk is Influence of Pelletization, Particle Size, and Incorporation of Binders, and that's for higher alcohol synthesis using K-dope, cobalt, rhodium, molybdenum sulfide, multi-walled carbon nanotube catalyst.
Thank you. Well, thank you very, very much, Gary, and I just wanted to thank Lucy and Gary for putting an excellent symposium for Bert. Just on a personal note, to congratulate Bert for this distinguished research award from the division of ACS. So I'll be talking about the higher alcohol synthesis using alkali promoted cobalt rhodium molysulfide on multi-wall CNT, and especially focus on the particle size pelletization and effects of binder on the catalyst performance. My co-authors are Venkat Surishetty, who got his PhD working with DuPont in Kingston, and Philip is a current PhD student who is continuing this particular work. So if you look at the world oil reserve, it's mostly dependent on oil sands bitumen 30%, conventional oil 30%, extra oil, heavy oil 25%, and heavy oil 15%. And so most of the research and development work will go into these areas, and it's very energy intensive process, and also there is pollution issues associated with it as well. And to look at this slide in the right, looks at the total metric ton of carbon emitted per year, and in a billion, the unit is in a billion tons, and mostly it's emitted by petroleum, coal, and natural gas, gas industries. Therefore, the alternate energy resource becomes very, very important. And the advantages are they're renewable and readily abundant, and it can basically reduce the CO and CO2 emission. And also it's environmentally benign in terms of no nitrogen, no sulfur emission. So the higher alcohol synthesis, which basically higher alcohol is a complement, which basically supplement the alcohol of the gasoline and diesel fuel, is produced by a catalytic hydrogenation process in this particular case, in which your hydrogen is converted into higher molecular weight alcohols at higher pressures, 270 to 330 degrees Celsius, and a pressure of 5 to 10 megapascal. So the main reactions are given here are producing water and CO2 as a byproduct, and the upper side reactions produce paraffins and olefins, and also the water gas reaction consuming CO2 produce additional hydrogen, which may be required in the system. So what is the motivation in producing higher alcohol? Because it has a low vapor pressure and better solubility and miscibility with gasoline, and it can blend well with gasoline or substitute green fuel. The presence of oxygen can enhance the complete fuel combustion. So if you look at this particular slide, you see that one can produce syngas from many different sources. One can gasify coal or biomass or import natural gas to produce syngas. And of course, the syngas gas has to cleaned up before going through a higher alcohol synthesis or a fissure crop synthesis process to produce alcohols or waxy material. So the focus has been, in our case, basically the catalyst development for the higher alcohol synthesis. So if you look at the overall economics of the GTL process, you'll find that about two-thirds of the total capital cost is for syngas production and cleaning, and about one-fifth of the cost is for either FTS or higher alcohol synthesis reaction, and that includes the reactor itself and CO2 removal unit, synthesis gas compression and recycle unit, and the recovery of hydrogen and hydrocarbon unit. And of course, it requires upgrading and refining, which costs about 1/10 of the overall capital cost. So in our research, we have been focusing on the middle section, which is the basically the reactor or catalyst development section. And if you do that, of course, that will reduce the overall cost for the GTL technology. And there will also be, if you produce selectively, then that can directly affect the size of the syngas generation section, as well as the reactor volume also can be reduced. So if you look at this particular slide on the higher alcohol reaction pathway and catalyst required for these processes, and if you start from the left side, it says syngas, and you can use some kind of FT type of catalyst to produce mixed higher alcohols and paraffin waxes, etc. And if you go to the top right, so you get ethanol by rhodium-based catalyst, or you can go to methanol by copper zinc oxide on alumina catalyst, and then you can also produce acetic acid, for example. So syngas has been a building block for making either paraffinic hydrocarbons or maybe higher alcohols, or you can make some nice chemicals. And if you want to focus on the syngas to higher alcohol synthesis and look at the literature, one would find that the alkali modified molysulfide based catalyst is quite useful. Why? Because it has higher resistance to sulfur, and it is active for water gas shift reaction, and it can produce linear alcohols. However, higher alcohol selectivity is very low for this particular material. Therefore, the addition of transition metal promoters to this catalyst can increase the higher alcohol selectivity. So what are the strategies to improve the higher alcohol productivity? So there are two ways. One is the technology, the other one is the catalyst itself. Our focus has been the catalyst development. And for our novel catalyst development, there are different ways one can do. And we have been looking at some active metals as well as the catalyst support. So if you look at this particular slide, the potential catalyst support for higher alcohol synthesis should have many different parameters that one can look at. And in case of meso or macro porous support, I've divided into three different sections. So it's a metal oxide based, silica based, and carbon based. And we are interested in the more in carbon based material because it's a resistance to acidic and basic environment, and it has a diverse porous structure and can easily easy accessibility due to interconnecting pores, easy recovery and regeneration of catalyst, and moderate metal support interaction. It has low density and possibly low cost. And when I visited, as Gary mentioned, to the Energy Center in 2003, there was a group working in the carbon nanotube area. That's where I got exposed to CNT area. And when I returned back, then started working in this particular area. So it has been about 7-8 years or so. We've been working on the production of carbon nanotube and its application for various processes. And in this, and also started the Fischer-Tropsch synthesis project as well around 2004-2005. And I also have done a PhD in Fischer-Tropsch around 1990. So there were about 15 years. So I revisited what has been has happened in that particular area at the center. And when I went back, started working in the higher alcohol synthesis and Fischer-Tropsch synthesis area. That has been about 7+ years. And that's you can see the CNT has been very good support for both Fischer-Tropsch and higher alcohol synthesis reactions. And we have been able to synthesize also very high quality material. So if you look at this particular particular slide, it says it's a new generation of material. And we just basically have a sheet of graphite rolled up in a similar cylinder. And it can be meso or macro porous depending on how you manufacture it. And it can eliminate diffusion and intraparticle mass transfer. And surface area is also varies from 50 to 500 square meter per gram, with the internal diameter from 5 to 100 nanometers. The surface of the nano tube can be functionalized, and also the catalytic site can be located inside or outside depending on the requirement. So when you take a graphene sheet and you roll up in a cylindrical form, you find that this pi electron density is shifting from inside to the outside. So the inside is more electron deficient, so if you put metals inside, it's much easier to reduce than if you put them outside. And why we are using CMP as a support? It can improve the higher alcohol synthesis reaction by reducing diffusion and also increasing the dispersion. It has high surface area compared to alumina and silica, can have lower molecular size, and it can be reduced, the metal can be reduced at lower temperature, and there's also lower interaction between metal phase and CMP. And it's a mesoporous material, therefore mass transfer resistance can be lower, and it can be functionalized. Therefore, you can easily adsorb CO onto the surface dissociatively, and it can also improve the chemisorption of hydrogen and CO. If you look at the higher alcohol synthesis catalyst, there are basically two types. One is the modified methanol synthesis catalyst, modified fischer-tropsch synthesis catalyst. And in this particular case, the alkali modified high pressure, high temperature, alkali modified low pressure, low temperature materials. And in this case, you have got three different categories. You have rhodium-based, and also iron, nickel, and cobalt-based, and also alkali modified moly-based catalyst. And we are interested in this last category, which is alkali modified moly-based catalyst. Why? Because it has high resistance to sulfur, active for water gastric reaction, produces linear alcohols. The only problem is the higher alcohol selectivity is very low. And because it's low, one can look at adding the transition metals to this catalyst to increase the higher alcohol selectivity. And the reactions that you see is very very complex as a Fischer-Tropsch synthesis reaction, but by manipulating the catalyst material and the support material, one can certainly increase the ethanol and higher alcohols from the synthesis gas. If you look at the catalyst support again, so you basically have metal, different oxides, and different carbon materials, and we are of course interested in the CNT as I already explained. So if you look at the literature, one would find that there's limited studies in alkali promoted cobalt rhodium moly sulfide based catalyst for higher alcohol synthesis reaction. The effect of binders has not been studied, and also the effect of particle size the different particle size on the catalyst performance has not been studied, especially looking at this particular system. Well, what are the hypotheses? So you basically put a student project, you just have to have literature review and come up with some kind of a hypothesis to then you prove them one by one or disprove them. So the hypothesis here is the higher surface area and attractive texture properties of multi-wall CNT would enhance higher metal loading and subsequent metal dispersion and support. And diffusion of reactant or product and out of pores would be enhanced due to the mesoporous nature of the support, mitigating probable mass transfer limitation. And there is a strong interaction between cobalt and moly, which would facilitate the C1 to C2 homologation step for higher alcohol synthesis. And the porosity of the catalyst, as well as the mechanical properties, would be influenced with the incorporation of binder in the catalyst formulation. And then finally, look at the effect of particle size, and again, play around with the diffusional properties of the material, and to enhance the rate of the reaction. So the main objective here is to investigate the influence of particle size, palletization, and effect of binder on higher alcohol synthesis using the alkali promoted cobalt rhodium moly sulfide on CNT. And there are different sub-objectives given here to address the main objective in this work. So I looked at different catalysts that you see in this particular slide. We started with monometallic moly sulfide, alkali promoted moly sulfide, And here is the adding the potassium between 3 and 9% and moly between 10 and 20%. So from that work, we found that 9% cobalt and about 15% moly is quite effective for making higher alcohol from synthesis gas. So we took that particular composition and then added the promoter cobalt and rhodium by varying this from 3 to 6 and 1 to 2%. And that study indicated that if you take about 4.5% cobalt and 1.5% rhodium, that is that increased the selectivity further. Then in the third stage, we looked at combining cobalt rhodium on moly and looked at comparing its performance with that loaded on activated carbon, both micro and mesochorus, and compared the performance with that loaded on multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So if you look at the catalyst preparation method for these mono, bi, and trimetal catalysts, you'll find that the CNT was first treated with dilute nitric acid, 30% nitric acid at 110 degrees C for 5-6 hours, and just to create the defects and hydroxyl sites on the CNT, and then impregnate potassium using potassium carbonate, and then after stabilization, impregnated with ammonium salt, ammonium heptamolybdate, and here is the cobalt acetate tetrahydroxide and rhodium chloride. So these are the source of moly, cobalt, and rhodium. They are also appropriately loaded depending on if you want to make a dry dye or a trimetallic materials. So that's the way the materials are prepared. And once they are prepared, we also looked at screening some of the binders to make these pallets a little bit larger so that it can be used more industrial scale. So when you did that, so these are the binders that you screen, and these are the some of the factors that influence the binder properties. So if you look at the several regions why we eliminated five binders and selected these three. The three that are selected are bentonite clay, coal tar, and humic acid. So in the presentations down, you'll find that it's a BC, CT, and HA for these three binders. So the catalysts were palletized by using these three binders, and also looked at the strength, and also we produced them different sizes. And the catalyst before our testing was sulfided using 10% H2S in hydrogen, and then the temperature and pressure were maintained in this particular reactor for the higher alcohol synthesis reaction. So when you took the fine particles, we basically mixed them with silicon carbide, 90 mesh particles, and then we had 46 and 16 mesh particles, silicon carbide particles, were put on both sides of the main catalyst bed. And then we also had a 3 millimeter glass beads. Again, that is to enhance the interaction between the liquid between the solid solid and gas stream, so that the plug flow is maintained and we have a wall effect, etc., are kind of minimized. So look at this particular slide. So what we have here is the first bar here shows the alkali promoted moly, and here is the 4.5% cobalt moly on both on multi-wall CNT. So if you see that without cobalt, we have about close to 58% methanol and about 22% ethanol. But as soon as we added cobalt, then you can see that the shift of alcohol to higher alcohol to C2, C3, C4 alcohol, and also you have got up to C8 alcohol produced by addition of cobalt. So what is happening here, that due to strong interaction of cobalt species with moly, the presence of cobalt in alkali promoted moly sulfide enhances the C1 to C2 homologation step that leads to ethanol as the dominant product. And in this particular slide, you see the effect of rhodium. So you have got a material alkali bromated moly on CNT, no rhodium, 1%, 1.5, and 2% rhodium. So what we find is that without rhodium, the moly is reduced at 516, 19, and 787 degrees C, so plus 6 to plus 4, and here is plus 4 to 0. And as soon as you add a little bit of rhodium, so there is a shift of this reduction temperature to much lower temperature. And again, that's kind of somewhere around 392, 396, shifted from 519. And then once you add 2%, you find that this is again increased because there's a somewhat interaction of rhodium with moly, and it's preventing it to reduce at lower temperature, and that's increased to some extent. So what is happening here? So the rhodium species basically in catalysts are capable of catalyzing dissociation, insertion, and hydrogenation of CO, and improves the formation of alcohol. So this is a material that's really helping the reduction of moly and increase the selectivity of the higher alcohol. So this is a Jane's analysis for our materials, and you'll find that alkali promoted moly sulfide indicates more oxidized sulfate and molybdenum sulfide species in the catalyst. This one shows the XRD pattern, and this is kind of the desired catalyst, alkali promoted trimetallic, 4.5% cobalt, 1.5% rhodium, 15% moly, and 9% potassium. This is about 30% material loaded on multi CNT. And if you look at this D here, you can see how these materials are very well dispersed, and you don't see any significant peak for these materials. Let me summarize the catalyst activity and selectivity study here. So you have got alkali promoted moly on CNT, and here is bimetallic cobalt moly, here is trimetallic, rhodium moly bimetallic, here is trimetallic. So when you have the trimetallic catalyst, you find that the CO conversion is higher, and we also produce about 0.29 grams of total alcohol per gram of catalyst per hour, the same amount of total hydrocarbon, and higher alcohol selectivity, including the ethanol, is about 39%. So then if you take out the potassium, you can see what is happening to the higher alcohol. It goes down to 1.5 from 39, and as I mentioned in the Jane's work, that potassium is critical to keep this moly and moly sulfide phase. And when we replace that multi-wall CNT by activated carbon micro and meso, the conversion is it's not bad, but if you look at the higher alcohol synthesis, selectivity is very poor. So that shows that the multi-wall CNT works much better than activated carbon for the trimetallic catalyst for producing ethanol and higher alcohols. And also we did the work for about 720 hours, but this one is kind of if you look at the image for alkali promoted trimetallic catalyst on CNT and activated carbon, here it's kind of not more uniform, here it's kind of agglomerated in some cases, producing large particles. And if you look at the deactivated catalyst, the EM picture of deactivated catalyst operated for about 720 hours, we found that there are very little deactivation, especially on CNT promoted, CNT supported catalyst compared to activated supported catalyst. Here the particle has grown to about 100 nanometer, but here the particle has grown not more than 20 nanometer. Then what we did, if you look at the, so now we have optimized the composition of the material, and now what we did is look at the temperature, pressure, gas solid space velocity, hydrogen to CO ratio optimization. And we find when we did this optimization, and our constraint was to maximize the ethanol space time yield and maximize the ethanol selectivity. So these are the optimized condition. As you see, temperature is 330 degrees C, pressure is 1320 PSI or 9.1 megapascal, and gas solid space velocity is this, and feed to and hydrogen to CO ratio is 1.25. And so this is the predicted value, and this is the observed value through experiment, and that was obtained at these conditions. And then what we did is we wanted to use a binder to look at how do we produce suitable particles for trying in larger units. So what we did here is we have one-treated CNT, and this is the reflux with the nitric acid, and you have 30% bentonite clay, and here is the binders, coal tar and humic acid. And what we find, and here is the amount of cobalt, potassium, moly, and rhodium loaded on this material. And I just want to bring to your attention that once we have these binders, then the surface area and then the pore volume reduced to some extent. Nonetheless, you can see that the bentonite clay may be a bit preferred in this particular case. And when you had these trimetals loaded, here is for fine powder. Here is no binders. Basically, it's 88 micron. Here is about 1700 micron. And these are the ones that they are used to the binder, trimetallic catalyst binder. And the surface area was reduced again, and so was the pore volume. When you compare the physiochemical properties for these three cases, you find that bentonite clay may be a little bit better compared to other two binders. So this was the nitrogen adsorption isotherm. Here is the ones that without metals, and here with the trimetals. So it looks like that the mesoporosity is maintained. And here is the pore size distribution. And this is for catalyst one, which is basically powdered material. And then these three are this is pelletized, but no binder. This is pelletized with binder, so there's a reduction of catalyst porosity with the incorporation of binder, as you saw in the previous slide. And there's exhibition of broad pore distribution by binders incorporated catalysts. Here is the FTIR data indicating that we have both carboxylic acid and OH stretching obvious from this material. If you look at the total acidity, there is basically very low amount of acidity in this material, but nonetheless, most of that contributed to the carboxylic group present in the material. And the laser Raman spectroscopy indicates the defects in this material just by looking at the ID to IG ratio, and it shows that there is no real any fixed pattern of the defects created by using the binder with this trimetallic catalyst. And the X-ray pattern indicates that we have got both all three moly oxide and also the graphitic peak and the potassium moly oxide. This one represents the one made with humic acid, which indicates that there's inhomogeneous dispersion. But in the other two cases, it looks like there's a little bit better dispersion, so you don't see a lot more peaks. And this reflects mostly the moly oxide and cobalt moly oxide. So if you look at the TGA, I should point out that this material was calcined at about 500 degrees C for about 3 hours. When we looked at this material here, and we also see that somewhat the mass loss, and minimum for this one here, catalyst one, and maximum for catalyst three. Here is the crossing strength. Again, catalyst two is much better, where the binder is bentonite clay. The effect of this is the CO conversion on the particle size here. So you increase the particle size to 1700 micron, there's a somewhat decrease in the CO conversion. And here for other material, this shows that by increasing the particle size, the internal mass transport diffusion is dominating, therefore the conversion is way down. This one shows the effect of temperature for powder material, and 330 degrees C is kind of optimum for higher alcohol synthesis. And this one shows the effect of particle size and binder on alcohol production. So here is the methanol, ethanol, propanol, and butanol.
The first one is the powder catalyst, and the red one is 1700 micron, no binder. And these are for the other three binders, the bentonite clay, and here is the other two materials. So it shows that the binders have somewhat a negative effect on the higher alcohol synthesis. So let me summarize. We find that the incorporation of binder into alkali promoted material affected the textural properties as revealed by PT analysis. And OM titration confirmed the total surface acidity is a bit low in this case. And Raman work indicated there are some defects on the sides and there's an inhomogeneous dispersion, especially on humic acid incorporated material. And of all the binders, we find that the bentonite clay may be a little bit better compared to the other two. And so we find that crossing strength is indicated as mechanically quite strong. And we find that the maximum higher alcohol synthesis is about 38%. So what are the key messages? The key message is that one can use the multi-dual CNT as a catalyst support without any problem. And we found that you can put the metals inside and sometimes perform better than if you put outside. And so in this material, you can put 30% of all these alkali CO, rhodium, and moly are still quite active and active for a long period of time. We have tested up to 720 hours, as I said, and the deactivation was hardly 1 or 2%. And now we're just kind of looking at palletizing it and increasing the strength. So we have applied for a patent for this particular composition. And also we have applied for a patent for iron catalyst as well for on multi-wall CNT. So, and published about 40 plus papers in the last 7 plus years, especially in the higher alcohol synthesis and physiotrop synthesis area, mostly by working on multi-wall CNT and saw some presentation this morning on the carbon nanomodern as well. That's another work we are continuing. So with that, just wanted to acknowledge the ENSER Canada Research Program and EBIN Network for funding. And so this one shows the green fuel work great, especially after adding to gasoline engine. And thank you for your attention.
We have only time for one question.
Well, yeah, I was wondering, have you compared some of your carbon nanotubes to some commercially available ones or some graphene?
We have actually compared that with alumina supported materials and also in FT case. So we find that this outperforms the alumina supported metals for higher alcohol synthesis as well the isotrop synthesis. Some of them we have already published, so one I can send you some reference.
No, I meant, have you compared with commercially available carbons?
The activated carbon that I showed is actually, it's not our own carbon. It's uh-huh. obtained from industry.
Okay.
Oh yeah, we have.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. By the way, this is Saskatoon in winter. You see the winter in the summer and the other one in the summer. You want this? Thank you.